Good afternoon, learners. Today we are here to discuss the poem Prospice, written by Robert Browning, a Victorian poet and playwright. As you can see in the PPT, the poem is prescribed in your syllabus UGEN 101 new. Title of the course is Reading Poetry, Block 1st, British and Indian Poetry, Unit 2nd, Robert Browning. Prospice. I am your assistant professor, Dr. Amit Kumar Singh, from the School of Humanities, UPRTU, English Department. Every poet is creation of his own age. Every age has created several poets, writers, novelists, playwrights, etc. The impact of the age is that every poet feels some tendencies related to his age, and these tendencies expresses in his works. In the same way, Browning was a product of his age. Now, we will know something about the poet. As you can see, he was a Victorian poet and playwright, primarily known for his dramatic monologues. He was born on May 7, 1812, Camberwell, London, England. His mother was Sarah Anna, father Robert Browning, and his wife was poetess Elizabeth Barrett Browning. He died December 12, 1889, at the age of 77, Venice, Italy. His resting place is Westminster Abbey, as he wished his ashes were buried lying there in Westminster Abbey. Primarily known for lyrics and dramatic monologues, as I told earlier. He is also noted for social commentary, characterization, challenging vocabulary, etc. He is also liberal supporter of women emancipation. He was a voice for the women in the Victorian era, because in this era, women have limited legal rights, and Browning fought for them. Now, first of all, as we are going to understand the poem, we have something to know about the Victorian era in brief. Let's start. At the time, Britain was most powerful empire in the world. During the time, Queen Victoria was reigning, and Britain was one of the most powerful nations of the world. There was a stable government, a growing state, and expanding franchise. India was one of the franchise which was delivered by the British government. The era saw rapid growth of middle class replacing the aristocracy as British society's dominant class. In this era, middle class people came to the forefront. They dominated the upper classes and took the place of primarily social class. More important was placed on family and values. More important was placed on family values. In this era, family principles and values were overpowering all the things. People were chiefly concerned with family and family's values. Marriage based on romantic love gained popularity. In this era, marriage based on romantic love was accepted by the society. A clear separation was made between home and the workplace, which was not before. A clear separation was made, means in office and in family, there was a gap, as the office was a working place and the family was a resting place after the work. It was a place of serenity and calmness. So, the more values were put on the family. Women were expected to focus on domestic matters and to rely on men as breadwinners. Mostly, in the Victorian era, man was doing for the earnings and his bread, and women were rely on heavily on the men for their economical support. Women had limited legal rights, so a feminist movement developed. In this era, women had very little legal rights, and against this, a feminist movement arose. Children were provided with legal protection apart from parental authority. State-funded schools were opened for the first time. Now, in this era, children were protected by the law apart from their parental authorities, and state-funded schools were first time built in England. Further, now the historians use a term, Victorian Compromise, which denotes and explains the chief qualities of Victorian era. What is that? Let's see. G.K. Chesterton coined the term Victorian Compromise in his book, The Victorian Age in Literature. First time, G.K. Chesterton used the term Victorian Compromise, which is described in his book, The Victorian Age in Literature. The term refers to the contradiction between progress brought on by industrial revolution and the poverty, disease and sufferings felt by the working classes as a result of this progress. Victorian Compromise, the term, refers to the reality and gulf between the rich and poor. The rich in this era were feeling all the luxuries, reaping all the luxuries of the life, while as the poor were suffering. They had hardly earned their bread and butter. They were struggling for a single penny, and this gulf was even broadened by the Industrial Revolution. While the middle class and upper classes enjoyed advancement in wealth and quality of life and reaped the benefits of an expanding empire, the working class suffered greatly. Laborers were suffering greatly because they had limited rights, limited values in the societies. They had to work hard for their single penny. They had to work by day and night for their livelihood. So this era saw a depth gulf between the rich and poor also. Forced to work into close overcrowded rooms and poor living conditions, workers were often at the mercy of their dangerous jobs in textile mills, mines or railways. Mortality rates were high and child labor was a common killer. Along with disease, it was the triumph of capitalism and the birth of Marxism. It was the age of Darwinian science, but also the age of Dickensian romance. Now, Victorian age saw the clash between poor and rich. Poor were heavily rely on the mercy of machines in the works like textile mills, railway, and big coal mines, etc. There were no medical claims. There were no PF segments. There were no safety measures for them. They had to only work and rely on God for their living, for their health, for their wealth, and for their life. The Victorian age was a complex and contradictory era. It was the age of progress, stability, great social reforms, but it was also characterized by poverty, injustice, and social unrest. Here, further, the Victorian age was complex and contradictory era. It was a complex and contradictory era means it was mingling of poor, rich, pressed, suppressed, overpowered, crowded, etc. It was the age of progress. Definitely it was the age of progress because the English Empire was expanding over the world. Its franchise were separating the world. Great social reforms, but it was also characterized by poverty, injustice and social unrest. A handful of people, no doubt, got the success. They earned heavily. They reaped all the luxuries of the life. But majority of people were poor and they faced injustice and social unrest. Respectability was a mixture of morality and hypocrisy, severity and conformity to social standards. It implied the possession of good manners to ownership of comfortable house with servants and carriages, regular attendance at church and charity activity. In Victorian era, there was also a term named respectability, which was a mixture of morality and hypocrisy, severity and conformity to social standards. And it denotes also the luxuries of life. If a people having all the luxuries of life, it, as ownership of comfortable house with servants and carriages, regular attendance at church and charity, he was called respectability. He was called respected. And the respectability, like in this term, was used. The term Victorian compromise denotes the conflict between science and religion, poor and rich, revolution and reconciliation, war and peace, educated and non-educated, etc. Victorian compromise now also denotes the compromise between science and religion. One side, people were believing in religion. The other side, science was a dominant thing. People were moving towards science. New scientific inventions made them believe in this physical world. Poor and rich, revolution and reconciliation, war and peace, educated and non-educated, etc. In the Victorian age, the people were highly conflicted between science and religion. In the Victorian era, people were not understanding what they should do. If they should believe in religion, or they act like science. New scientific discoveries making people's outlook very clear. It was not a miracle, it was work of a man. And therefore, science took the dominant role over religion. Scientific development conflicted the people in the heart, especially Charles Darwin's theory that tells man originated from monkeys. Now, in this era, Charles Darwin's theory tells the people that man originated from the monkeys. Now, what happened? The people before this era were believing in religion and he was thinking that man is originated from the God. He is boon of God. And from the boon of God, he is incarnated into this world. But scientists like Darwin say simply that man is originated from monkeys. And it gave a theory that man is not made by the God. It is originated from the monkeys. Now, come to the poem. Praspice. Praspice is a Latin phrase, or praspice. Sometimes people call it praspice and sometimes people call it praspice. Most often you will heard praspice. Praspice is a Latin phrase which means go forward, look forward, go beyond. The poem written by Robert Browning is in the form of dramatic monologue. Now, the question arises, what is a dramatic monologue? To see, dramatic monologue, first of all, I would like to tell you, monologue is made up of two words. Mono means single, and log means dialogue or discourse. Hence, a single orator and his discourse is monologue. Dramatic, it is dramatic, of course. It is dramatic in the sense there is high rise and fall of the action, situations. Poet or speaker starts at a critical moment in the poem which forms the whole of the poem. Dramatic monologue originated from Greek word monos, alone, solitary, and logos, speech. It is originated from the Greek word. Two words are Monos and Logos. These two words are Monos and Logos. Monos means alone, solitary, and Logos means speech. Hence, Monos and Logos means a solitary speech, alone speech. Mono means single or only, and log means dialogue or discourse. It is a dramatic because it reveals dramatic rise and fall of action and situation. A poem written in the form of lengthy, unusual length and tedious speech. Often, the dramatic monologue falls into the category of tedious poems, monotonous poems, because the speech is too long for the auditors. It compresses into a single vivid scene and narrative sense of the speaker's history and psychological insight into the character. Dramatic monologues also shows huge insight into the character's personality with dramatic situations. So, it is also called dramatic log. It is a kind of lyric poetry. Now, it is categorized as a lyric poetry. But why it is called a dramatic monologue, I have told you earlier. It is also a kind of lyric. It is a part of lyric, but it is named dramatic monologue. It is a kind of lyric poetry and uttered by an imaginary single speaker who is presently, clearly, evidently not the poet. In this type of poem, there is a single speaker which tells the whole story of the poem. But this speaker is certainly not the poet. It may be his inner self, his soul, or someone other who is expressing the poem. And throughout the poem, monologue, dramatic monologue, you can feel the presence of auditors. This is a major difference between soliloquy and dramatic monologue. In soliloquy, you cannot hear the auditor's presence. In soliloquy, the speaker talks to himself, which is not heard by others. But in dramatic monologue, there are indications of the presence of the auditors, and we know them. This person utters the speech that makes up the whole of the poem in a specific situation at the critical moment. This person addresses and interacts with one or more other people. In such type of poems, the speaker interacts with one or more other people, and we know it. He is interacting with someone or some more people. But we are aware of the presence of the auditors, listeners. And we can acknowledge that there is someone who is present. But in soliloquy, you can't find such things. They say and do only from clues in the discourse of the single speaker. And in the discourse, in the dialogue of the single speaker, you can see what is going on and which type of people he is interacting with. This is the major difference between a soliloquy and aside from the dramatic monologue. Next, prospice. We are discussing the poem prospice from the point of view of explanation. In this section, we will explain the poem, what is the idea behind the poem, what the poet tries to say, what the poet tries to explain with you, what is poem about. Prospice, to look forward ahead. Prospice, as I have told earlier, that prospice is a Latin phrase and it means to look forward, go ahead. In 1861, the wife of Browning was dead, and the poem was written shortly after that death. It was completed and published in 1864. The poem is one of the most optimistic poems by the Robert Browning, and it has certainly its place in the optimistic poems of the world. This poem is about death, love, and so many things. How a dying man feels after what happens, the death, why the death should not be taken as an arch enemy, why a man should not be afraid of death. These certain questions are answered in this poem, and Browning has tried to give answer these questions. Now let's have a look to the text. Poem starts with, "Fear death, to feel the fog in my throat, the mist in my face." Poem starts with a rhetoric question. Rhetoric question means? Rhetoric question is that where the answer is not necessary, that answer will be given by someone. It is a question to form the poem, to ask a question, but answer is not necessary. It is the part of a poem to inaugurate, to excel, to operate a poem, to start a poem. So, fear death. Rhetoric question, fear death. To feel the fog in my throat, the mist in my face. Should I fear death? Here the speaker asks questions. Should I fear death? To feel the fog in my throat, the mist in my face. He compares himself a dying man. Dying man, he compares dying man from a mountaineer. As a mountaineer goes high and high to the summit, to the peak, in the discourse of his journey, he feels fog, mist, snows, and blast of the snows. As a mountaineer feels all these sufferings, all these things, in the same way a dying man feels all these things. Should I fear death? To feel the fog in my throat. When my throat is choked with cough at the time of death, should I fear the mist in my face? The dimness of my eyesight is blurred. Should I fear death? When the snows begin and the blast denote, I am nearing the place. As a mountaineer is closer to his target, he feels snows, very cold. In the same way, a dying man feels the coldness of his body when he is nearing the place, means death. I am nearing the place. Here, nearing the place means death. I am feeling cold, very cold, and so I guess that I am about to die. In these circumstances, should I fear death? Further, the power of the night and the press of the storm, the post of the foe, where he stands, the arch fear in the visual form, yet the strong man must go. Now further, the poet says, I am nearing the place. The power of the night and the press of the storm. You have often seen or feel, or often heard about your ancestors, grandmother, grandpa, your father, mother, that a dying man feels a whole darkness around him, absolute darkness around him at the time of death. All the worldly affairs have gone. There is nothing which his eyes can see. He sees only a gloom of darkness, a vast darkness, and this darkness is so bold, so intense, he can't see beyond it. In the same way, poet says, the power of the night, the press of the storm. I feel a gloom of despair, a horrible, dense darkness, the press of the storm. My body feels like a storm inside. A dying man, when the soul is departing from the body, feels a storm of emotions. A dying man feels separated from his soul. Soul body is tightly clinched to the soul. And when the soul tries to left this ragged physical body, it causes great pain, great suffering. In the same way, poet says, the press of the storm, I feel a presence of a storm into my body. The post of the foe. Now, where he stands, the earth here in visual form. Now he visualizes death. Death in front of him is presented like a visual form, like in a visual form. He seems that death is present before him like a manly form. Where he stands, the earth here in visual form, yet the strong man must go. He can easily see the death. But before death, he will attain the summit, means he will go to the post of the death, means where the death resides, where the death lives. He will firmly go there without fear. Next, for the journey is done and the summit attained and the barrier falls, though a battle to fight or the guardian gain the reward of it all. For the journey is done and the summit attained. Now the speaker says that he has attained all the works. He has submitted his all the works. He had completed his all works relating to this world. He has no work yet to done. And now his only work is to be dead. For the journey is done and the summit attained. I have completed all the worldly affairs, tasks. And my single work is to be dead. And the barrier falls. When a mountaineer comes to the point where the summit is near, he feels that all the barriers have fallen. All the problems, coldness, darkness, hard breathing is gone. In the same way, when a dying man is near to death, all the bodily existence problems have gone and the soul is ready to free. And the barrier falls, though a battle to fight or the guardian be gained, the reward of it all. But before my death, auditors, speaker says, before my death, I had to battle with death, a duel with death, to get all the reward of it. And it will be the best reward. Before I death, I will definitely will be in a duel with death. This arch big enemy, which is in front of me in a manly shape, manly form, visual form. I was ever fighter, so one fight more, the best and the last. I would hate that death bandaged my eyes and forbore and bade me creep past. Here the poet says, I was ever fighter, so one would fight more. I have performed my all worldly affairs and duties and works like a fighter, like a hero. I was ever a fighter. In my life, I was ever a fighter. The best and the last, so one fight more. So one fight more, which would be the best and the last with death. I have performed my all the duties with heroic zeal, enthusiasm. In the same way, I will fight with death like a hero. I would hate that death bandaged my eyes and forbore I would simply hate that death blindfoldly covered my eyes and crept me past and command me to creep silently to the other world. But though I was a fighter, so I will fight a last battle and the best with death. No, let me taste the whole of it, fair like my peers. The heroes of old bear the bolt in a minute, play a glad life a year of pain, darkness and cold. Now, the poet says, no, let me taste the whole of it. Wait a moment. I was ever a fighter. I would hate to creep past. I would like to taste the whole of it. It means I would feel very happily all the agonies, pains and sorrows of death before my death. I would not happily surrender to the death, in front of death. Fair like my peers, heroes of old, fair like my companions, my friends, my forefathers, I will face death heroically. As they fought against this death and immortalized them, in the same way, I will fight with death and immortalize myself. Bear the brunt in a minute, glad played life's year of pain, darkness and cold. For sudden, the worst turns the best to the brave, the black nets at end. I would be happy to feel all the pains and agonies provided by this death, darkness and cold. I would happily assimilate this darkness and cold provided by death. For sudden, the worst turns the best to the best. Why should I fear death? For suddenly, worst thing in this world turns best for the brave. These lines remind us of one line of the Shakespeare in Julius Caesar. Coward dies many times, valiant tastes the death but once. It means coward people dies many times before their death, but the brave in their whole life taste death but only once. In the same way, I was ever a fighter, I am a brave person, and I will make my fortune by fighting a duel with death. I will not surrender. The black minutes at end and the elements raise the fiend voices that raise, shall dwindle, shall blend, shall change, shall become first a piece of out of pain, then a light, then thy breast. And after this fight, there will be a time, a period of calmness, serenity. I will be able to feel calm at the time of the death. A dying man feels a thundering, a blunder of emotions, and a fiend voices, unknown voices heard within his heart. He can hear the different voices which arouses within his soul. No other can heard it. Hear it. So, after this, then a light, then the breast. And after this duel, there will be a period of meeting with you. Then a light, then thy breast. O thou soul, my soul, I shall clasp thee again, and with God with the rest. And after this brave fight, a brave duel, there will be reward of it all. And the reward of it all will be the reunion of my soul with thy soul, your soul. And there will be God, where we will live happily reunited once again, as we were using to live in this world. This era, this time period, will allow us to reunite with one another. of our forefathers, ancestors? No. This will allow me to reunite with you. And in the presence of God, both soul will live happily, calmly, and with serenity. So, thank you. This was the explanation of the poem Prospice by Robert Browning, which is one of the most optimistic poems in the world of English literature. And for next lecture, we will be here soon, and we will try some literary movements, literary texts, literary compositions. So, thank you once again. Thank you.